If you're like me and you are interested in the microbiome and knowing exactly what organisms make up your own microbiome, then the GI map test is the way to go. In this video, I am going to be giving an overview of exactly what is on the GI map test. Enjoy. Before we get into the details of this sample test result, let me just give you a little background information of how the lab determines all of these values from your sample. So basically, you're going to submit a stool sample to the lab, and through a process called polymerase chain reaction, or PCR, they're able to detect the DNA that's in your sample and amplify it, and from that they can see all the different species in your stool sample in real time. So this is a snapshot of all the organisms, at least the ones that they test for. It's a snapshot of what is going on in your gut at that time. So as you can see here, they categorize each type of organism they find based on our knowledge. So for example, these organisms here are known as pathogens, and pathogens are things that cause problems. So in this sample report, we could see elevations in Clostridia difficile toxin A and toxin B. These are genetic variants of this microorganism, and C. difficile normally lives in our guts in harmony, doesn't typically cause problems. It's generally kept in check by other organisms, but sometimes you get genetic variants which will produce some of these toxins, and that's why this one is considered pathogenic. And as far as the amount that they find here, this is written in something called scientific notation. So this means 1.21 times 10 to the fifth power. So whenever you're going through these results and you want to get like a quick overview of just how bad it is. So for example, this toxin A is to the fifth power. And so you see that their reference ranges go to the third power. So this is magnitudes greater. So this is actually a lot of this toxin. So always look at this number right here for a better reference than just looking at the first number. So we have all the pathogens that they check for, and then they have some parasitic pathogens. These are some single-celled organisms, and then viral pathogens. Moving on to the next page, they test for Helicobacter pylori. This is one of the species of bacteria that is implicated in causing gastric or stomach ulcers. And the cool thing about this test is that they not only detect the presence of this microorganism, but they also detect genetic variants of this organism that have been known to cause more problems, because a percentage of the world population has this species in their gut. And if you watch my video on H. pylori, I give more details on this. But not all people have problems whenever they have this organism in their gut. But there are some subspecies or genetic variants of this organism that do cause problems. And the cool thing about this test is it tells you all the different species. So when you go to your doctor and they suspect you have H. pylori, it's cool if they just do like the normal breath test, which tells you that H. pylori is present. But this test is even better because it tells you if that organism is one of the ones that is known to cause some of these more, severe symptoms. Next, we could see the normal bacteria that's in the test sample. And these are the ones that we want to shoot for. So whenever a patient is low in one of these phyla, or low in some of these single species in the phyla, then we want to make sure that we're given probiotics to help build these ones up. And most of the probiotics out there are ones that are beneficial to us. So when you take a probiotic, we expect it to be something that's going to help. And most of the species are within this phyla in probiotics. Next page, we have the opportunistic bacteria. So these are the species that, you know, they normally don't cause problems. Some of them might live in our guts and be in harmony. They're not stealing our resources. They're not hurting us. But if their population gets out of control, meaning you're getting less beneficial bacteria to crowd them out, so it gives them an opportunity to take over. And this could happen if you're taking antibiotics. If you take an antibiotic, it may kill off some of your friendly bacteria. And if it doesn't affect any of these species, then their populations will grow. And you can see here that at least three different species are elevated in this sample. Not too bad though. Pseudomonas is times 10 to the fourth. Pretty close, not too elevated. Same thing here to the fourth. Same thing here to the third. In this section here, we have the potential autoimmune triggers. These are species of bacteria that have been implicated or correlated with individuals who have autoimmune conditions. So in somebody who has, say, a Crohn's disease, we may see more elevations in some of these species, maybe Klebsiella. So if you are suffering with an autoimmune condition and you have this test done, it's a possibility that some of these species here, if they come up elevated, are the ones that could be contributing to your condition. Next here we see the yeast species, and I've done this test on several patients, and so far I haven't seen any of these species in the yeast category come up. I know someday I will, but I haven't seen it yet. And then here's a couple viruses that might show up too. I haven't seen these clinically yet as well. Next page are the parasites. So these are the organisms who steal your resources and harm you as well in the process, kind of like a mosquito. I made a video about this. I'll put a link down below with more details on parasites. But in this case, none of these were elevated. And I rarely see, on the tests that I've done of this on real patients, I haven't seen these, any protozoa in any of the samples yet. And I haven't seen any worms in any of my samples yet, but someday I will. And in this section here, it shows you if you have enzymes to break down certain components of food, and if you're not absorbing fat, it'll show you that here. Here, in this case, this sample person's beta-glucuronidase was high, and if you watched my video about hormones, I'll put a link down below for that one too. I talk more about beta-glucuronidase. Some species of bacteria produce this enzyme, beta-glucuronidase, which could reactivate estrogen, making you have an estrogen dominant state. So I'll put a link down in the description for that video as well. Here they test for occult blood. This is very important, especially if you are losing blood. You know, you do your blood test and you see that your red blood cell count is low and your doctor's wondering, you know, where is this person losing blood? Well, let's check the stool first. And if this is elevated, they need to rule out cancer, because if there's blood in the stool, even if it's a small amount of blood, it's cancer until proven otherwise. So very serious stuff. Next are the immune response. This is secretory IgA, which is basically, it's called an immunoglobulin A, which is found in your mucous membranes. Mucous membranes are things that, like the inside of your nose, the inside of your mouth, all kind of wet surfaces will contain these immunoglobulins, which are basically weapons of your immune system. So in this case, they're testing the immunoglobulins that are in the gut. So in the protective lining of your gut, that layer of mucin that protects your gut, they can see the level of secretory IgA. And if this is elevated, it's indicating that your body is actively responding to something. And however, if it's low, it could be an indication that your body has already reacted to something and is kind of like running out of secretory IgA. In any case, one of the probiotics that you can take that will increase your secretory IgA is actually something called Saccharomyces boulardii. And we usually give this one to people who have diarrhea as well. I'll put a link down in the description to a product. And here we have anti-gliadin IgA antibody. This is basically one of the reactions that somebody could have to gluten. So if this comes back and it's elevated, then you probably want to stay off of gluten because you may have an issue with digesting gluten. Your immune system may think that it's a foreign invader and be chronically trying to attack it, setting up an inflammatory situation. And speaking of inflammation, this tests for calprotectin, which is an inflammatory marker. We often see this elevated in patients who have irritable bowel disease, such as Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, but we'll also see it in people who haven't had that diagnosis. It's just an indication of inflammation in the gut, and it's a good thing to follow if you have a patient who is having high calprotectin, and you give them a treatment and you retest it and the calprotectin's lower, then you have something objective to show you that your treatment is actually working. And here's an add-on test. By default, I always add this one on. This is zonulin. This is a protein that is found in the tight junctions. So the lining of your gut is made up of cells, and the cell's lifespan is about 4 to 5 days. So every 4 to 5 days, the cells that line your gut, they'll pop off and new ones will push up and replace them. Well, what triggers these cells to pop off is a protein called zonulin. So if we see a sample such as this one, which has high zonulin, we could assume that there's a lot of cell turnover going on in the gut, meaning there's cells may be dying at a faster rate and being replaced by new cells. Well, when this process happens, the tight junctions that hold these cells together, they become loosened, which makes you susceptible to having objects that are inside of your gut come into closer contact with your immune system, and maybe larger particles are able to get into the bloodstream, which cause an even greater immune reaction. We call this process leaky gut. So when the tight junctions are too loose and larger proteins could get into the bloodstream, then we would say a patient has leaky gut, which is just a terrible inflammatory condition. Leaves you susceptible to having chronic gut issues. So this is a very, very good marker. Next page here, and this is the last page, I believe. Yes, this is the last page. This shows you just a breakdown of the antibiotic resistance. So they test for H. pylori, Helicobacter pylori. They test the genes of this organism. If it's present in your sample, they'll test the genes of it. And from that, they can tell you if that organism in you has a resistance to certain antibiotics. So if you're going to be treated, that they know exactly which antibiotics to give you, which ones will work and which ones probably won't work. So in this case, this Helicobacter has a resistance to clarithromycin and tetracycline. So these antibiotics wouldn't be a good choice to use. You'd want to use maybe the fluoroquinolones and amoxicillin. And then they also show just non-specific resistances, because in case you didn't know, different species of bacteria may develop genetic mutations which give them resistance to antibiotics. And they will pass these traits between species, which is crazy. So now let's take a look at the company's website, because I want to show you, if you do have this test done on yourself, where you could get more information. So it's diagnosticsolutionslab.com. And for patients, you'd go to here and then you would click on learning. And then you could click on the interpretive guide, and it gives you more information on exactly, you know, what each individual type of organism does, what we know about it, just to give you some more information that your doctor may not give you. And that's it. If you're looking for a great tool to see exactly what's going on in your gut and get a good snapshot of your microbiome, then you may want to ask your doctor to order the GI map test. If you like this video, consider giving it a thumbs up. If you haven't already, please hit the subscribe button and click the bell so that you don't miss out on videos just like this one. I thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.